I invite you to keep your Bibles open to that passage. We'll look at that in a moment. Just also want to make sure you know that Dr. Liam Gallagher is in the midst of our summer series on the book of Esther. He will be taking that up next week, so you might want to make sure you're here as well. It's been a wonderful study on a book that carries so much of the gospel that we need to hear and be reminded of. The following week, he will not be in the pulpit, so I'm doing a two-week, two-series kind of thing based on this passage. I want to spend this morning talking about the centrality of the cross of Christ. Objectively, why is this cross so important for us to understand? In 2 weeks, I want to look at the application of this cross of Jesus Christ, particularly for you and I who profess to be Christians. Why is it important that you and I really understand the application of the cross of Christ in our lives daily? But we're going to look at that objectively first and then more subjectively in 2 weeks. In the meantime, I think it's important before we look at this particular passage to understand what's going on in this passage. We really have to step back and take a look at the context of what we just heard read. What was actually going on here? And by way of advice, that is a fundamental principle of wisdom, isn't it? To be sure that you and I step back and get the whole picture. Have you ever been in a discussion where you thought you understood and somebody said something and you suddenly realized, I had no idea of all these other things? That really helps me. Or my wife and I just finished a jigsaw puzzle. I need the whole picture in front of me. I got that thing right in front of me the whole time because one little piece just doesn't make sense, but in the big picture of things. So it's important for us to step back and take a look. Paul was writing to a church, a body of believers in the city of Corinth. This was a port city, and although it wasn't the largest in the empire, it was one of the most popular in all of the empire. It had quite the reputation. It was a place of great commerce, and therefore they had one of the highest standards of living. You had everything you want in Corinth. It's a great place to go. They also had the reputation of a strong and independent spirit and sharing of ideas. They loved to think, challenge, grow, and have the freedom to think anything they wanted. It was a great place of interaction and learning. This could also be seen, by the way, in the vast number of religions that were in that city. There were so many views of life and so many religions that were popping up. Hey, let's try this. This is the way to get to the deities or the gods that we need to know. So these ideas furnished new religions, but they also had a reputation for loose living as well. High levels of immorality when it came to any kind of morals or values. One commentator described Corinth this way. He said, Corinth was the New York City, Los Angeles, and the Las Vegas of the ancient world. You put all those together, you got Corinth. You got everything you want, everything you need. This was a hip city that had it all. It was a great place to be. Paul really saw that they prided themselves, this city prided themselves as being great thinkers and debaters. They loved to debate. The men of Greece were considered some of the wisest and most gifted debaters of their day. It's really wonderful to watch a healthy and good debate. But I would suggest the ability to debate well seems to be a rare commodity in our day and society. It has been uncomfortable and even embarrassing at times to watch some of our political debates that quickly turn into character assassination rather than the issues that need to be discussed. But I fear, friends, that our discussions and debates in our own homes look pretty similar to that. We don't know how to listen and debate. I grew up in a home where debate quickly turned into a series of painful and frightening words that were meant to hurt, not to heal or understand. It was frightening for me as a child to grow up in a home where you didn't debate, you attacked, and you destroyed. I fear the same thing is happening in much of our society today, and yes, even in the church, where the rallying cry seems to be both figuratively and literally, shoot first and ask questions later. Get your point across, even if you have to kill somebody with words. Shut them down. That's the way you win an argument. What a tragedy. What a tragedy that we don't know how to listen. But that's a sermon for another day. Amen? We need to deal with that. The debaters of the day in Corinth, they were much more persuasive and eloquent in their speech and easily convincing with their arguments. This is the world the Apostle Paul was speaking into with a message that would clearly divide and cause people to decide. He was coming with a message with people who love to interact and think with something that was going to call them up short. And it all centered on the cross of Christ. He even clarifies how and why he is coming. Look at verse 17. We didn't read that, but look at how Paul is setting himself up. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of eloquent wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. It's about the cross. The centrality of the cross of Jesus is absolutely essential to understanding and living the Christian life. One theologian put it this way. This is a good theme for you and I to think about as we go through this passage. He said this: to move beyond the cross is not to move on at all, but to abandon Christ altogether. You don't move on from the cross. You don't look at the cross and say, thank you, Jesus, I'll take it from here. You always have the cross in front of you. It is that central to the Christian life. Where can you go that the cross must not be there? I want to focus on how the centrality of the cross is necessary for you and me to understand two fundamental things. I think the cross, based on what Paul is saying here, really helps us understand the world. It gives you the foundation and perspective needed in understanding what is going on in this world. The cross brings it crystal clear into focus. Second, I want us to see that the centrality of the cross is necessary for us to understand our own salvation. If you are a professing follower of Jesus Christ, I want you to see the centrality of this cross that Paul is talking about. The cross, in many ways, is to be our new identity that will carry us to eternity. Remember, to move beyond the cross is not to move on, but to abandon Christ. It's that important. So let's look now at the centrality of the cross and how it helps us in understanding the world. I want to suggest to you at least three of the many ways that the cross explains the world. First is this: Paul is wanting the believers here in Corinth to understand as well that the cross, in many ways, it's the centerpiece of history. The cross is really a centerpiece. You want to understand history, look at the cross. It's that important. All of the Old Testament, and particularly the prophet Isaiah, looked forward to this very day of the cross. The day when the promised Messiah, the Anointed One, the great Redeemer, that day would come That day when he would finally deliver all his people. There will be a day, the prophet said, when the Messiah will come and rescue and save his people. There truly was never a voice like his. There was never a life like his. There was never a death like his. In all of history, Jesus on the cross is the centerpiece and key to understanding this world and the world to come, for that matter. A second aspect or understanding of the world that comes here, when it comes to the centrality of the cross, that the cross, yes, it's that centerpiece, but secondly, the cross is the great historical divide of every person. It's the historical divide of all people. It's not only a centerpiece, it's a dividing piece as well. Look again at verse 18. Paul says, the word of the cross is folly or foolish to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Paul is making a clear statement, isn't he? Do you hear what I'm saying? You hear what Paul is saying? The cross does this. There are only two kinds of people. Those who are perishing or those who are being saved. The theme of this passage is that when it comes to the Lord and the cross, you are either foolish or you are wise. There is no middle ground at this centerpiece, at this dividing piece. You either see Jesus for who he is or you think he's a fool. I don't need this. Or, God have mercy, I need this. There's no middle ground. We're not talking about three kinds of. Paul says you either are perishing or you are being saved by the cross of Christ. Paul explains this division of people and applying it to his own Corinthian context. For the Jews, the promise of debate and convincing argumentation was through signs. Signs. The Jews had seen God work in history through great signs. So their mantra was, we'll believe it when we see it. Show me the money. Show me how it works. And we'll believe, because that's the way God works. That's the way you win arguments. You show the proof. For the Greeks, Paul saw, their foundation was human reasoning. The ability to analyze, debate, and draw conclusions was the essence of life and wisdom. You just use your powers of reasoning and debate to come to right conclusions. This challenge of understanding life, I believe, is the part of everyone made in the image of God, whether you want to admit it or not. There's something deep in your soul that says, I want to know what life really is all about. Who am I really? Who is God if he is? My friends, that doesn't come from anywhere but that the work of God in your heart and life. You will never find rest till you find rest in him. Yet, according to Paul, there is no middle ground. You either see the necessity of the cross or you see it as another foolish attempt to make sense of life. Nobody knows what they're doing, and you got this Christian thing going on and somebody on a cross. Yes, if you want to believe that, that makes sense. Go ahead. It's just another foolish attempt. Nobody can really know. You professing Christians, this is a good place to pause and ask an obvious question. When was the last time you really, really stopped to survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died? When was the last time, professing Christian, you stopped and looked at the cross? third piece of how the cross helps us understand the world, I think, is more personal and direct. The cross of Jesus is not only the centerpiece of history and the great historical divide, it is especially the great heart divide. The great heart divide. We see that verses 19 through 23 as Paul goes after that. The cross is meant to be the most in-your-face event for every individual to look upon. The cross is after you. It's not after concepts and arguments and debates. The cross is about your heart. If you really look at the cross, it's going to look at you. It's going to divide your heart. If you really look at it and think about it, this cross is as much about you as it is about the God who made you. This cross is to help you understand who you really are and what you really need. The first thing Paul says it does is to fulfill the Old Testament prophecy of Isaiah. Look again at verse 19. What does this cross do? It is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. The wisdom, the power of the cross destroys the wisdom of the world. As one commentator said it at the crucifixion, here's what happens, quote, he has brought an end to human self-sufficiency. The cross has brought an end to human self-sufficiency. It's in your face, saying you've got to deal with Almighty God. Paul makes his point further by being somewhat sarcastic. Look at these rhetorical questions in verse 20. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe or the lawyer? Where is the great debater of this age? And then he closes it out with that following statement. Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? He elaborates on this further about how we are unable to understand apart from that. Look at the end of chapter 2, verses 14 and 15. Paul says, the natural person does not accept the things of the Spirit of God, for they are folly or foolish to him, and he is not able to understand them because they are spiritually discerned. Dividing the heart. If you stop and think about it more closely, I think the cross really cuts to the heart of the matter. When it comes to the essence of sin, and that is pride. Pride. Somebody tells you, you don't know what you're talking about. Somebody presses a button in your life and you don't like the way it responds. Have you ever had that happen? Have you ever been caught up and find yourself immediately angry and wanting to win at any cost? That's pride. To be told that your best and most sincere efforts in knowing God are foolish without the cross, that can feel insulting. You mean to tell me I'm being as sincere as I can, I'm trying to be honest as much as I can, you mean to tell me I can't know this God apart from the cross? That's stupid. That's foolish. I think I know how to be right with God. Pride. Paul addressed this same concern in Romans 1 when he said this, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth, claiming to be wise, they became fools. What does pride do? When you are convicted, you gotta suppress it, don't you? I gotta hold that down, because if that pops up, I'm gonna look like a fool, and I am not gonna look like a fool. Even if it costs you your reputation, even if it costs you your life, I am not gonna look like a fool. So I will suppress the truth that is haunting me, that I'm aware of. There are many reasons the cross seems foolish to the unregenerate mind, but here are just three one author highlights that get to the nerve of it. One is the fact that Christ died as an atoning sacrifice. Look closely, friends. The cross says this: someone had to do something for you that you could never do. Jesus was not a martyr dying for a cause which the world sees as noble. It's much better to see Jesus as, boy, he's a great guy, great teaching, great man. And I feel sorry that they killed him, but boy, he died for the cause, didn't he? Let's follow the cause. Jesus was not a martyr. He was a savior. And he died for you because you could never be right with God apart from that cross. That's why some people think it's foolish. Second, it's offensive because the centrality of the cross says that is the only way to be right with God. If you don't believe in the cross, you don't know God. You talk about arrogance and insulting to great debaters, great thinkers, great people, and you are probably one of them in some ways, aren't you? But when God says, you have nothing to stand on except the death of my son, and until you see that, I can't hear a thing you're saying. We have no discussion. It is that central. That's offensive. It's also a difficulty for non-believers to get their heads around, to believe in the sufficiency and the power of Christ. If he could not save himself, how could he save me? Your great king got killed, and you want me to believe that he could save me when he couldn't even take care of himself? In other words, a powerless king would die a shameful death. That just doesn't make sense to me. Oh, but the truth of the gospel is that the cross is our only hope in this life and the next. So we see that the cross indeed is foundational for us to understand the word. But my brothers and sisters, it is also critical for us as Christians to understand our own salvation. Look what Paul says in verse 23. But we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. His bottom line in preaching was that Christ and him crucified is all he knew. It's foolishness to the wise person. It's powerless or a stumbling block to those who want proof. It will never save you. But to those of us who are being saved, it is the basis for our understanding of our life in Christ. Christian, if you really want to keep your eyes on Jesus, keep your eyes on the cross. A key phrase for you and I to understand as Christians is found right in the beginning of verse 24. Don't gloss over it. Paul says, but to those who are called. To those who are called. The first thing to be reminded of as a Christian is that God alone is the one who opened your eyes to see that cross and understand. His spirit made you see Jesus for who he really was, your Savior. You know, it's amazing. Have you ever been around where you have so many people can look at the same thing and see something very different. Have you ever experienced that? My wife Bev and I, we would go to art museums. She's the artist of the family, art history background. She loves art. I'm the typical, what's that mean, kind of guy. We're in the art museum and we're looking at these paintings, and a lot of them are complex and all this stuff. And I'm looking at them like, remember years ago, where's Waldo? I'm playing with these paintings. I'm going up and trying to figure out, where's Waldo? I wonder if he's in there. And my wife said, would you come over here? Just step back. Look again at that painting. Do you see what's going on in the lower right corner? That's the focus of the whole painting. Look at that and step back. And I did. And I said, wow, I had no idea. Look at that. That's a beautiful painting. And she said, no more, Waldo. Would you just look and listen and see there's something beautiful here? But isn't it amazing that we can see different things and looking at the same thing? You know, I have family members and even friends who look at the same cross I look at and are not moved. It doesn't mean anything. They see a great teacher and a martyr, but they don't see a personal savior. You know, it's not always blatant rejection of this Jesus. What hurts even more for me is to have a relative say, that's nice, but it doesn't mean anything. It's an indifference to who Jesus really was and why he came. Why is that? Why can't they see Jesus? If I think for a minute it's something good in me, I'm not really looking at the cross. Jesus died for sinners. He died for people who were blind and dead, like me, like you. The centrality of the cross for the believer is something we must never want to lose sight of. The symbol of the humiliating death to us who are being saved actually is the place of life. The symbol, in many ways, is the bottom line in understanding the love of God. Think, my friends, it was his son, his perfect only son, who died for me. He who knew no sin became sin for me. Do you see that? Do you see that? I would suggest to you the Apostle Paul himself knew the significance of the cross in his daily life, and he expressed that passion to believers in this church of Corinth at chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Look at that with me. Paul is coming to them knowing his life is being threatened. He doesn't have time. He doesn't know how long he's going to live. He is rushing into their presence. Look what he says. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming to you the testimony of God with lofty speech or wisdom. I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. He could have said, I just want to know, do you love each other? Are you taking care of each other? Do you love God's word? Are you hanging out with other Christians? I don't have much time. Here's my bottom line. Do you know Christ crucified? That's what life's about. That's what I want to remember. In 2 weeks, we'll take a closer look at how the cross applies to our lives more specifically. But for now, believer in Jesus, know this. When you look at the cross, you see through his eyes again the power and the wisdom of Almighty God. Whenever you wonder in your own faith and are weary about his love and power, you need look no further than the cross. And let me clarify here, we do not worship a dead Savior hanging on a tree. We worship a resurrected King who has conquered it all. Yet, we should never be outside the shadow of the cross. That old gospel hymn says it this way: Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Oh, friends, that's the centrality of the cross. And I would be negligent here if I did not pause and address you who are outside of that. You see a cross, but you don't see it. If your heart is stirred, if you are intrigued, maybe even you're convicted, you know something is missing and that that cross has something to do with it, I beg you, look at the cross again. He died for you. He paid it all for you. He loves you. When God opens your eyes personally, then that confusing cross makes all the sense in the world. He is not after the brilliantly wise and self-sufficient. He is after the broken in life and spirit. He came to die so that you might live. May we believe the cross and keep it before us, both now and evermore. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that you keep your eyes on us. And by the work of your Spirit, you want us to turn our eyes daily upon you, to indeed look full in your wonderful face, to see our Savior, yes, on that cross, and knowing that in that cross is the fullness of the wisdom and power of God, and to have him is to have life eternal. Bless us even this day, that we would see Jesus, for we pray in his strong name. Amen.